Hey now, Rodney R. Dixon here, and today I'm going to be showing you how to compress and uncompress a file archive, more commonly known as how to zip and unzip a file archive. Now, what is a file archive? A file archive is essentially a file, generally a singular file, with a .zip extension. Now, within this file can be one or many files that can then be extracted onto one's computer. So that being said, what are the benefits of a compressed file format? Well, let me touch on the three main ones. One, by doing so, you can password protect and encrypt a file archive. So let's say you had sensitive information that you wanted to send to somebody. Now, you're fearful that it may be intercepted by a third party, and you don't want this third party to access these files and see what is in them. By compressing a file archive and giving the file archive a password, essentially what you are doing is you are preventing anybody, or at least making it very difficult for anybody without the password, of accessing the files contained therein. Reason being, of course, because the contents of the compressed file archive are encrypted. So even if, let's say for example, someone who's very knowledgeable in decrypting software were to get their hands on it and try to read the contents of the file from within, the contents would be encrypted without the needed password, and therefore they wouldn't be able to see the contents of the file archive easily. Secondly, a file archive can group many files into one file. Now, this is especially useful for those who wish to send a multitude of files to another party. Let's say, for example, you wish to send a relative many images from your latest trip, your latest vacation. The problem is you have over 40 images. Attaching each one by email can be cumbersome. Well, what you can do with a file archive is you could simply group all these files into one file archive and send that one file archive to the person, which on their end they could uncompress and have access to all the files without any fuss or bother. The third benefit to a file archive is that there is a compression element to it. So essentially what compressing an archive will do is, in code terms, it will remove empty data such as leading zeros, trailing zeros, line breaks, spaces, essentially any data that is not inherently necessary for the integrity of the data to remain. The compression software will remove these bits and elements. When you, of course, uncompress the data, these elements, which any program or any compression program can basically recognize, will once again be injected into your files. Basically, in a nutshell, what it's doing is it is shrinking the files themselves, it's making them smaller when they are compressed, and when they are uncompressed, they are restored to their full size. So there you go, three key benefits to compressing and uncompressing. Now, as mentioned prior, zip is perhaps the most common file archive. Why is it the most common? It turns out it was the most popular for many, many years, going back to before Windows 95, back in the 90s with DOS. And as a result, it has become somewhat of the industry standard. Not to think that that's the only file archiving process around. There are many. There are RAR, ACE, ARG. There was one that began with C. I forget it now. Anyway, but basically what I'm getting at, there are many types of file archives. They essentially perform in the same manner. However, as it turns out, zip is obviously the most popular, and therefore it is the most easily recognized and the most compatible with most computers. As it turns out, chances are if you have a Windows XP or later operating system, at least on the Microsoft side, you should have a built-in file extractor, which will allow you to uncompress and extract zip archives from direct in your operating system. No software needed. You could do it directly in the operating system by double-clicking on the zip file. Now, if you don't have access to this, or if you'd like the ability to also create zip archives, which, with the benefits mentioned prior, is obviously an asset, you could download this free utility. Now, this is an open-source freeware utility, which means that the actual code of the program is made available to the public. What's the benefit of open source freeware? Essentially, with the code being made available to the public, you could ensure that the public will publicly scrutinize the program, which means that it is highly unlikely that open source freeware programs have any maliciousness such as spyware or adware or Trojans or any nefarious code within them. For the most part, it's generally completely safe and, as a benefit, completely small and efficient software, as 7-Zip is. Now, 7-Zip can be had at the following URL, 7-zip.org. Once you go to 7-zip.org, you'll be brought to this page. If you're a Windows user, you're going to want to download the .exe executable version. Now, this is if you have a 32-bit operating system. If you have a 64-bit operating system, you could obviously get the .msi and install it. I myself am currently using a 32-bit operating system. It should be noted that for the most part, even 64-bit operating systems allow you to run software in 32-bit compatibility mode. So the only benefit to getting a 64-bit version of the software is slightly improved performance. In my case, since I'm on a 32-bit operating system right now, I'm going to click on the first download link, which should begin the download of the 32-bit version. And there you go. Just like that, it reads 7-zip, your download will start shortly. And from there, a pop-up window comes up and says, you have chosen to open 7z920.exe, blah, blah, blah. Would you like to save the file? At which point I could then select save file and save it to a file folder on my hard drive, on my computer. Now, I've already done this, so I'm just going to skip to the part where the file is downloaded. So here you go, this would be the file you have downloaded. Now, very important, if you're on a Windows operating system that is post-Windows XP, that is to say Windows Vista, Windows 7, or Windows 8, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to right-click on this file and select Run as Administrator. Once again, right now I'm on Windows XP, I don't have to run as administrator, so essentially I'm just going to run the software. It reads, the publisher cannot be verified. Are you sure you want to run the software? Yes. I select Run. It asks me where I want to save the software, where I want to install the software, I should say. In this case, I'm going to go with the default folder, which is /program/files/7-zip. I'm going to click Install. The installation process takes place. It completes and reads, completing the 7-zip 9.20 setup wizard. 7-zip 9.20 has been installed on your computer. Click Finish to close the wizard. I'm going to click Finish. There we go. 7-zip is now installed on my computer. So let me take you through a tour of 7-zip. Here in this folder, I have two pictures of myself. As it turns out, one of the pictures is 351 KB. The second picture is 1,393 KB. Let's first see the benefit of compression. In this case, I'm going to compress the 1,393 KB image. Now, it should be noted that both of these images are in JPEG format, which is already a compressed format, Will there be much compression? No, but perhaps there will still be a slight amount. So, the way to compress in 7-Zip, the easiest way, is in a file explorer, such as when you double-click on my computer, and you have access to all of your hard drives and file folders and what have you on your computer, you have what's called a directory context menu, which comes installed when you install 7-Zip. And the way it works is you could right-click on a file in File Explorer, and you have a 7-Zip submenu. And you have the options. Add to archive, compress an email. Now be forewarned with compress an email. Compress an email will compress, but it will open an email client. Now an email client is generally a POP3 IMAP or SMTP client, such as IncrediMail, Eudora Mail, Thunderbird, or Outlook. If you don't use one of those programs, if instead you used a web-based email, you're not going to want to use this. Here we have some quick links. For example, this will create a quick 7-Zip archive. Once again, you have the option to email it. And here we have a quick link to add to a zip archive instantly. Without any bells and whistles, I could simply, through the 7-Zip submenu, select Add to Rodney 2012, in this case because it's using the same file name as my file here. It's just changing .jpg to .zip. So 7-Zip, Add to Rodney 2012.zip. Let's see how that works. There we go. It should dump the file directly into the same folder, and there you have it. Rodney 2012.jpg is 1,393 KB. Rodney 2012.zip is 1,378 KB, so a smaller file. Now, how can we tell that our archive actually contains the files that we wish for it to contain? We could simply double-click on it, and by double-clicking on it, if 7-Zip is your default compressor and decompressor, you should see the archives. Right now I have a different compressor installed called WinRAR, so what I can do is in 7-Zip, the 7-Zip submenu once again, I could select Open Archive. And here we go. It shows my archive, and it shows that in fact within the archive is Rodney2012.jpg. There we go. It shows the pack size, and the date modified, date created, accessed, and so on and so forth. Now, let's say you want to uncompress an archive. We have an archive right here. We want to uncompress it. I just received this by email. Here, let's make things a little clearer. We'll create a new folder. We'll call it new. Okay, so in my new folder, I've just received a zip archive. I wish to uncompress it. I wish to see what's in it. How can I uncompress it? The easiest way, once again, with 7-Zip, is you could right-click on the file archive, and in the 7-Zip submenu, you could elect to extract files, where you could dictate where they'll be saved, extract here, so you could extract it to the exact folder you're in, you could test archive to ensure that your compression is fine, that the file is not corrupt in any way, and of course, you can recompress it to make an archive within an archive. For the sake of this example, I am going to extract the file here. There we go. The file has extracted, and as you can see, what was once 1,378 KB is now 1,393 KB. There you go. Perfect example. Now, let's take, for example, the notion of compressing a multitude of files. In this case, I want to send two files to somebody, both Rodney 2011-2 and Rodney 2012. Problem is, I don't want to send two files, I just want to send one file. Essentially, I want to send them as an archive. What I can do is I can drag my mouse over both of them, highlighting both of them. Alternatively, I could select one of them, hold the shift key and press up or down to select both of them, Or what I can do is, holding the control key, I can click on one of them, and still holding the control key, click on the alternate file I wish to highlight. Once I have both files highlighted, of course this can be more than two, this could be a multitude of files, including file folders. Once I have what I want to add to my archive, I can once again right click, 7-zip submenu, add to archive. This time, instead of automatically just adding to test.zip, and you'll notice that it's calling it test.zip. Why is it calling it test.zip? Because I'm currently in the d:\test subfolder that I made. Okay, so in 7-zip, I wish this time around I'm going to go through the hard work. I'm going to select add to archive. In add to archive, using this browse button, I could elect to save it within a different file folder, what have you. Very important, by default, the archive format is 7-zip. Now, is there a reason as to why we shouldn't use 7-zip format instead of zip? Well, 7-zip actually compresses better than zip. It's slightly more advantageous in the amount of space you'll save by compressing with 7-zip format. However, compatibility isn't across the board, whereas in most cases the other party would need explicitly the 7-zip software installed in order to uncompress it, whereas zip option is more of a global encompassing file archive that basically anybody could open. So in this case, I'm going to make it a zip file. I'm going to rename it. I don't want to call it test. I want to call it Rodney's Pictures. There we go. Compression level. I could choose whether I want to store it, fastest, fast, normal, maximum, and ultra. What is the difference? Store means there will be no compression. So why would anybody do store? Well, sometimes you want to group many files together as quickly as possible. See, all of these options, the more, how could I put this? The more advanced the compression standing is that you tend to use, the more resources of your computer will be needed, so the slower it'll be. For example, I'm going to take Ultra. Now, right now I'm compressing two small files, so it shouldn't be such a big deal. It should go along rather quickly nonetheless. However, if I was compressing many files of hundreds or thousands of megs each, this would take quite some time. For example, I often will compress a collection of files to fit on a DVD, a writable DVD, a DVD-5 format, which is generally around 4,400 megs. When I'm compressing 4,400 megs, just by storing them, which basically takes the least amount of processing power and resources, on a Core 2 Duo computer with 1 gig of RAM, this generally takes around 30 minutes, and that's just storing. If I go to an ultra compression for such a large file size, that could take overnight, believe it or not. In this case, once again, these are rather small files that shouldn't take too long. Compression method, we could leave that as is. Dictionary, all of this we could leave as is. Split into volume bytes. The way split into volume bytes works is, what we can do is, this is especially useful, let's say we were compressing over 4.4 gigs into DVD 5 size files. So let's say we were compressing 8 gigs worth of data, and we want to split it amongst two DVD 5s, which are 4.4 gigs. Once again, if we were to simply just compress it, well, guess what? That wouldn't help, because it would compress it, but it wouldn't compress it to a size which is under 4.4 gigs, so it wouldn't fit on a DVD 5. In that case, what we can do is we could select a predetermined, for example, a DVD. I could select this, a CD, if I'm burning to CD. Now, you'll see two versions of CDs. That's because there's essentially two sizes of writable CDs. There's a 650 meg CD and a 700 meg CD. In this case, I'm going to type in the number myself. I'm going to type it into bytes. for a DVD 5 in bytes, it would essentially be 4,444,444 bytes. That would essentially create a archive that would create two different archives that can fit on two different DVDs. Essentially, it would number them. It would automatically number the archives it creates into, for example, Rodney's Pictures, if we're still working with this file name, Rodney's Pictures 1.zip or Rodney's Pictures 2.zip. And when uncompressing, if I were to uncompress the first file archive, once the first file archive completes, it would automatically ask you for the second file archive, which you'd simply point to the second file archive and it would continue its decompression. Once again, that was just an example. Obviously, I'm working with a handful of megs here. I'm not working with anything that would require two DVDs. Okay, everything else can pretty much stay as is. You have the option to add and replace files, update and add files, freshen existing files, synchronize files. I've never played with this. I'm not going to get into it. You have the option of entering a password, as mentioned prior. So, for example, you can, let's say I want to put in a password and I want to call it pass1234. There we go. And I have to confirm the password, pass1234, make sure I have it right. Now what this ensures is that when I send the file over to the other person, if they don't have the password and they don't enter the password correctly, they will not be able to uncompress the file archive. So here we go, I'm going to leave things as is. So once again, I'm compressing these two files, compression level is ultra, and I have a password that is pass1234. Here we go. Okay. And as you can see, it's taking longer to compress. Now, this is because it's compressing using the ultra algorithm, which takes longer. Here we go. I now have my archive, rodneyspictures.zip. It has compressed both files together, and they are in one archive. If I wish to view what is in it, once again, 7-zip, open archive. There we go, both files are there, and you could see they're both in the same archive. If I want to extract them, right-click, 7-zip, extract files. See, and it prompts me where I wish to extract them. Here I'm going to leave it in the same subfolder. It's going to create its own subfolder called Rodney's Pictures, which is nice. Path mode, full path names, which means that if there were different folders in here, it would keep the folders, and if there are two duplicate files, it would ask before overwriting. Now let's say I go ahead and I don't enter a password. What happens? Look what happens. Enter password. Let's say I entered a wrong password. I just type whatever, do OK. Data error. Wrong password? Well, of course. Close. It didn't work. It created Rodney's picture, and it created the file names, but look, they're 0KB. They're empty. They don't have the actual decompressed content to them. So I'm going to delete that. Let's try again. Want to uncompress the archive. Once again, 7-zip. Extract files. This time I'm going to extract here. Going to make it a little easier. Boom. It wants to replace. Yes, because the files already exist. It didn't give me the option for a submenu. For a subfolder, sorry. Yes, enter password. This time I'm going to enter the correct password. 1234. Boom. Once again, same thing, because there are two different files that I'm overwriting. Yes, I could have chose yes to all, so it doesn't bother me again. And there we go. Believe it or not, it uncompressed. It's not clear because the files were already existing. Let's try it one more time. This time we're going to do 7-zip. Extract files. It's going to create its own subfolder called Rodney's Pictures. Very good. I'm going to type the password in advance. I could even show password so it's easier to see. This was the password I created. Here we go. Okay. Here's the new Rodney's Pictures folder. And as you can see, both files are there. They're intact. They have their file size. And they can therefore be read. So there you go. How else can I illustrate how compression and decompression works? Here is a good example. I'm going to take all my file content. I'm going to dump it into Rodney's Pictures. No. Okay. It only moved one file. Forgot about that. So there we go. There's now three files in this file folder. In this file folder, I'm going to create another file folder. I'm going to call it Image 1. And I'm going to put the 2011 image in there. In the next folder, I'm going to create an image, a folder in Image 1, and I'm going to call it Image 2. Image 2. What I'm doing by this is I'm illustrating the directory tree structure, the file folder directory tree structure that can be maintained. Here we go. So to illustrate, in Rodney's Pictures, I have the 7-zip executable. In the Image 1 subfolder, I have Rodney 2011-2, and in the Image 2 subfolder, I have Rodney 2012.jpg. Great. So I'm going to go back to my root, in this case, d:\test, and I wish to compress the Rodney's Pictures folder. So I'm going to right-click on it, but first I'm going to delete the zip archive so it doesn't get too confusing. Okay, great. So now with Rodney's Pictures, I wish to, once again, 7-zip, add to archive. I'm going to call this Rodney's Archive. Here we go, Rodney's Archive.zip. Once again, I'm going to stay with the zip format only because it's more easily compatible with all computers and it's easier for people to uncompress it with whatever uncompression software they have. Compression level this time, I'm going to do it as store, so it's going to go quicker, but it will not compress the files as much. There will not be that much savings as far as file size goes. Important to note, if you are compressing files that have already been compressed, even if you choose Ultra, it'll take a long time and chances are it won't be able to shave off many KB. So if you're compressing compressed files such as JPEG images, store isn't a bad solution, just to speed up the process. This time I'm not going to put a password. Not necessary, I showed it already. And I'm going to go ahead and say okay. You can see how fast it was this time. And there we go, I now have Rodney's Archive.zip. Now, I wish to extract Rodney's Archive, and Rodney's Archive, hopefully, will contain the subfolder Rodney's Pictures, will contain the subfolder Image 1 with its content, and the subfolder Image 2 with its content. So let's do that. Rodney's Archive, once again, 7-zip. I'm going to extract archives. I'm going to extract it in the subfolder, the designated subfolder called Rodney's Archive. Let's say I want to change it. I want to call the subfolder I'm creating it in, because I could rename it and give it whatever name I want. I want to call it Rodney's Test of Archives. There we go. I'm going to compress, decompress it into Rodney's Test of Archives. Here we go. Boom. Done. Look what it did. It created a subfolder called Rodney's Test of Archives. Great. Let's see what's in it. Rodney's Pictures. Great, that's what I wanted. I wanted Rodney's Pictures. Double click. In it, here's my 7-zip executable, and I have image 1, just as I wanted. Is my image in image 1 as well as the subfolder? Yes, it is. There it is. And look, it created image 2, the image 2 subfolder, as I wanted. Within the image 2 subfolder is, of course, my Rodney 2012 image. Well, there you go. That's basically compressing and uncompressing, or zipping and unzipping in a nutshell. I hope this information helps, and as usual, all the best.